Okay, so my name is Mark, and I'm filling in for Scott today. Let me just get your names real quick. When I point to you, just say your names, and how about remember who to say this good or bad.
Steve.
Austin.
Stephen.
Miranda.
Zach.
Sierra.
Becca.
Jared.
Kobe.
Jacob.
Kobe.
Like, after Kobe? Yeah. Literally?
Literally, yeah.
Okay, good. We'll have to talk later. Jacob.
And Kayla.
Colin.
Miranda.
Gianni.
Nico.
Ruth.
Oh, sorry.
Molly.
Ruth.
Ryan.
Anna.
Nick.
Aaron.
Alex.
Okay. So, on your paper or your screen, please make the following chart. List from A to E. And then you're going to answer the following question. Whether the person in story is actually ethical. And your options are yes or no. It's your only option. Okay. So first we have Alice. Alice's roommate Tasha asks her if she thinks the short story that Tasha has just written is any good. Alice says that it is a wonderfully written story, which is a lie, because she really thinks the story is wretched. However, she doesn't want to hurt Tasha's feelings. Based on Alice's encouragement, Tasha reads the story to a writing group and is thoroughly humiliated. She never trusts her roommate again. So, for A, Alice, was she ethical? Yes or no? So, pull it out here. Okay. Next up is Beth. Out of compassion, Beth gives $500 to a charity for starving children. Inspired by her example, many other students donate money to the charity that they would ordinarily spend partying. However, in order to obtain the money for the charity, Beth had to steal it from a rich stranger's purse. The stranger has so much money that she never realizes that it's missing. As a result of Beth's generosity and example, many children are fed. Beth, ethical, yes or no? Carl. Carl shoves Reggie to the ground simply to be mean. Unintentionally, however, his doing so had the consequence shoving Reggie out of the way of a falling brick that might have killed him. Carl, ethical, yes or no? Danny. Danny has been charged with delivering a professor's painting to a museum. On his way there, he notices a small girl drowning in a river. Knowing that every second counts, he throws her the painting to use as a float until he can get to her. Unable to spare the time fooling with his clothes, he then jumps into the water, wearing the good suit that he borrowed from his roommate. In spite of Danny's best efforts, the child drowns. He didn't save the child, and he ruined both the professor's painting and his friend Sue. Danny, ethical, yes or no? Okay. And last but not least is Eliza. Eliza sacrifices her weekends to work on a project that builds homes for the poor. She figures that the publicity from this work will help her campaign for student body president and will look good on her resume. The families that move to the home she has are overjoyed with the fruits of her labor. Eliza, ethical, yes or no? Now, you guys did a reading on reflective equilibrium. One of the ingredients of reflective equilibrium is usually particular cases. And in this case, judgments that you made on particular cases. For example, what Alice did was ethical. That's a judgment on a particular case or episode or event involving Alice, or what Beth did was unethical. And these are judgments on particular cases. Now, here's another question, and it regards general principles. What matters most for ethics is, dot, 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 and your choices will be A, B, and C. A, what you do, that is the moral value of the action that you perform. So a principle in this vein might be something like stealing, the act of stealing, is wrong. And as a way to find out, this is deontology, or deontological beliefs. So that's A. What matters most for ethics is what you do. Then there's B. What matters most for ethics is your intentions, that is your motives or character. Principle in this vein is something like trying to help starving kids is the right thing to do. That is the emphasis on trying intention. And as you'll find out later, this is in the ballpark of virtue ethics. So, and then C, what matters most for ethics is the consequences of your actions. That is the results. And the principle in this vein is something like getting starving kids fed is the right thing to do. And theories that go along with this are consequentialism and utilitarianism, which will be interesting. Okay, so here's your choices. What matters most for ethics is A, what you do, B, your intentions, C, consequences of your actions. Please write down your answer, A, B, or C. Okay. Now, if you don't want to raise your hand and tell me how you voted, that's fine. But we're all friends here, right? So, if you voted for A, raise your hand. You voted for B, raise your hand. You voted for C, raise your hand. Nobody voted for C? Okay, all right, you guys are anti-consequentialists. Well, you'll like Kantian ethics when you get to that, because C hates consequences and stuff. Okay, now, your moral philosophy, your moral view, your ethical view, here are some ingredients that go into it. One is your judgments on particular cases. For example, what Alice did was ethical. And another is the general principles you choose. What matters most for ethics is the consequences of your actions. So up top, we have particular cases. Down low, we have general principles. Okay? And here are some options for forming your moral view, your moral philosophy. Right? One is you could take the particular case approach, sometimes called bottom up. And in this approach, you follow the following procedure. You make judgments on particular cases. You look for patterns, and whatever formula fits your cases, you support as a general principle. We have the Alice story, right? Her action was lying, her intention was helping, and the consequences were bad. We we have Beth. Action was stealing, intention was helping, consequences were good. Here's Carl. Shoving, arming, good. Danny. The attempted rescue was, the intention was to help, but the consequences were bad. And last but not least, Eliza. Right, she was building homes for the poor. Her intention was acting out of her own self-interest or to be elected class president or whatever it was. And the consequences were good. And so, we have this. And let's just, you know, for the sake of argument, go along with assessing those in this way. X for being bad or wrong, right, or undesirable. Check for being right or good, praiseworthy. And if you're using the bottom-up approach, right, or the particular cases-based approach, right, you judge a bunch of cases, and then you extract principles from your judgments. So for instance, if you had this pattern, for whether they're ethical, whether Alice, Beth, Carl, Danny, and Eliza are ethical, if you had the pattern no, yes, yes, then action is the thing that matters most for you, ethically. And if you're doing the particular case-based approach, right, you say, okay, well, I did my judgments, and the pattern that I extracted, or the principle that I extract, is that the morality of the action, right, determines the morality of the person. Right? The act, the moral value of the act itself is what matters. And you follow that as your general principle. Anybody have that pattern? Okay. You may be budding deontologists. I'll tell you what that means later. Okay. You had this pattern, right? The principle you would extract is that what matters most in ethics is intention. So if you had yes, yes, no, yes, no. Anybody have that pattern? Interesting, we all, so like half of you said intention is what matters most in ethics when we're talking about principles, but in the actual cases, almost none of you feel that way. Okay, good. That will set things up nicely. If you think consequences, or if you have a following pattern, that will be consistent with consequences being what matters most. No, yes, yes, no, yes. Anybody have that pattern? Anybody have no, yes, no, no, yes? Nobody had that one either? All right. And things can get more complicated. If you had no, yes, no, 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 it seems to mean that you need both having a good intention and producing good consequences. Okay. We have this pattern, right, that seems to indicate that you need to have, right, a moral action, or an action of moral worth, as well as a good intention. And you get more complicated, you can get more cases. But that's the sort of particular case-based approach to forming a moral view. Okay. Now, that's not your only option. Another option you have for forming your moral philosophy is the general principle approach, the top-down approach. And here's how that works. You choose general principles, like for instance, what matters most in ethics is your intention. And then you support whatever those principles say or entail about particular cases. So since a good chunk of you said that intention is what matters most, if you're using the top-down approach, what is it? There it is. Okay. If you were using the top-down approach, right, We just take that principle, intention is what matters most in ethics, and just say, okay, well, Alice was ethical, Beth was ethical, Carl wasn't, Danny was, and Eliza wasn't. Right? You just go with whatever the principle says. Okay? So those are choices A and B. And there's also choice C, which is reflective equilibrium, which is the dominant approach in moral philosophy. And this is both a bottom-up and a top-down approach. And the procedure here is you judge particular cases, you choose general principles, and then you look for conflicts, you look for contradictions. And then what you do is you make adjustments and modifications to your judgments about cases, to the principles you select, until you resolve all the conflicts. That is, until everything is coherent, everything sort of fits together. And you go back and forth. And when you have done that to the point of resolving all your conflicts, you have achieved reflective equilibrium. And that's good. So, here's an example. Right. Let's say you choose the principle, killing is wrong. And you think, but killing Hitler would count as killing. But that would have been okay. Right, that's a counterexample to the principle killing is wrong. Well, what you can do is you can respond by modifying your principle to get killing that's not in self-defense or defense of others is wrong. You make that modification and you maintain the basic idea or the basic motivation behind killing is wrong. But with this modification, it now fits with killing Hitler is okay. And so you don't have a conflict anymore, you don't have a contradiction anymore, and your view is coherent. And you make moral, philosophical progress. And that's awesome.
Yes, sir. There still is some conflict in killing and that people still can blame others because people can say, what if that person wasn't attacking you? What if you jumped to an assumption?
Oh, what if you were, what if you thought it was a matter of self-defense, but it actually wasn't?
Yeah, what if the person was actually protecting you or was otherwise protecting themselves and you ended up killing them?
Well, then you would have been wrong. Right? You would have done something wrong, but perhaps you would have had good intentions.
So wouldn't the philosophy of killing this one for the sake of millions be a better philosophy to that principle?
For which principle?
For killing is wrong. Because the common philosophy is killing is wrong, but you could also say, well, one life does not equal 6 million. Mm-hmm. So why let one man be spared when he's taken over 6 million lives?
When you are forming your moral philosophy, your moral view, these are all good questions to ask. Are you asking like what's the correct answer?
I was just saying that this didn't sound like a reflective equilibrium to me because it was like it's so easy to be able to be torn down. Like.
Okay. Well, then that's just the next move. Okay? And you keep making moves. And you keep making adjustments to fit it all together. And you keep doing that until you are happy with your moral system, moral view. Does that make sort of make sense, sir?
Yeah.
Is that satisfying or unsatisfying?
Yeah.
I don't know. Anybody else have any questions? All right, so this is how reflective equilibrium works in moral philosophy. And it's the dominant method. And I method that most philosophers use. So, not whether you agree, not whether you like it, etc., but just whether you're sort of following the stuff that's tracking. Give me thumbs up for I totally get it, thumbs down for I have no idea what's going on, and thumbs in the middle for something. Okay. Okay. Okay, so we covered reflective equilibrium and ethics. And now we can turn to it in conceptual analysis. Right? So one thing that you can do in philosophy is you can analyze concepts. Right? Concepts like triangle or bachelor or cool or sandwich. And there's two components that goes into these analyses. One is called the intention, and the other is called the extension. The intention, that's intention with an S, is sort of like the definition or meaning of the concept, or we can just say word. Right? Sort of like it's the criteria for the concept applying. It's a formula that you can use to figure out whether a word fits with some object. So for example, the intention of triangle is something like one, it's a closed figure, and two, it has three sides. Right? So you confront this. And you're wondering, is this a triangle? Right? So these are the sorts of things you wonder, right? You come across a triangle and this, and you wonder if it's a triangle. Well, you can use the intention, right, as like a formula, as like a checklist. Is it a closed figure? Yup. Does it have three sides? Yup. Guess what? It's a triangle. Hooray. Right? You come across something like this, right? You say, is it a closed figure? Yes. Does it have three sides? No, it has four sides. Well, then it's not a triangle. Okay? That's how intention works. Okay. Extension is those things, the set thing, that the word applies to. So the extension of triangle includes this guy. Right? If we were to make the set of all triangles, right? Any of you math people, or one of the few people who actually use the squiggly brackets on the keyboard, right? That's a set. So you put the triangle here, it's in the set. Right? Or this thing can go in the set. This thing can't. For those for who is the markers, that's the square. Right? So the extension of a triangle, the word triangle, or more precisely the concept triangle, is just all triangles. Okay. Now, here's another example. Bachelor. The intention of bachelor, right, is unmarried plus male, right? And the extension are all the people who are bachelors. So Justin Bieber, you see how I make it real for you guys? Right? Okay, so Justin Bieber, right, he's a bachelor. He's in the extension of bachelor. Right? I don't want to, you know, overshare, but I myself am a bachelor. And you, sir, are you married? Are you male?
Yes.
You're a bachelor. Congratulations. Right? So him, me, Justin Bieber, we're all in the extension of bachelor. Okay. Now, conceptual analysis is not always as easy as triangle and bachelor. And actually, we'll see bachelor gets a little difficult. So for instance, what's the intention of cool? I mean, that's pretty hard to come up with a set of criteria. You know, a checklist that you have to check off to count as cool. And people are going to disagree what counts as a criteria. Or what's in the extension of sandwich? For some reason, the internet got obsessed with this question of whether a hot dog is a sandwich. Raise your hand if you think a hot dog is a sandwich. Raise your hand if you think a hot dog is not a sandwich. And don't let your classmates bully you if you think a hot dog is a sandwich. Okay, is a gyro a sandwich, is a wrap a sandwich?
Right.
Can you have a butter sandwich? Right, these are deep philosophical questions. Okay. So, ways to analyze concepts. Well, one way is the particular case approach, right? This is going to be very similar to what we did in moral philosophy, right? You judge whether particular cases are members of the extension, right? And you ask, does the extension of Bachelor, who does it include? For example, the Pope. Is the Pope a Bachelor? Raise your hand if you think the Pope is a Bachelor. Raise your hand if you think the Pope is not a Bachelor. Okay. So, what you do with the particular case approach, right, is you judge a bunch of cases and you look for patterns and you follow whatever formula you can extract from your judgments. Right? Now, if you think the Pope is not a Bachelor, right, Pope is unmarried and male, right? If you think the Pope is not a Bachelor, then unmarried plus male is not going to be sufficient intention for constituting a Bachelor. So that's the bottom-up approach. Then you have the general principle approach, or top-down. You choose general principles, or in this case, for conceptual analysis, you articulate some intention. Right? So for instance, Bachelor means unmarried plus male. And then you support whatever that intention, which is sort of playing the role of principles in this case, entails about cases, which is playing the role of extension, right? And so you would say, like, look, the Pope is unmarried, the Pope is male, so I guess he's a Bachelor. Okay? You just apply the formula. And that's the general principle approach. The dominant approach in philosophy and conceptual analysis is, once again, our good friend, reflective equilibrium, where you have both bottom-up and top-down. You judge whether particular cases are members of the extension, right? So you have a whole argument about whether a hot dog is a sandwich or not. Or actually, let me rephrase that. You contemplate whether a hot dog is a sandwich. You're getting some argument for my appeal to principles. So you just think about different cases, whether they belong in the extension. And then you choose general principles. That is, you articulate an intention. And then you look for conflicts, that is, contradictions. And you make adjustments and modifications until all those conflicts are resolved. Until everything is coherent. Until your system as a whole is coherent, everything fits together. And you go back and forth. So, here's an example, right? For Bachelor, right? Let's say you're identifying the intention of Bachelor, so you're identifying the criteria of being a Bachelor, and you say, well, you must be unmarried. But then you think about it and say, well, some little boy, right? Some 3-year-old boy, waddles in, right? You say, oh, that dude is unmarried. Also, he's male. Right? But he's not Bachelor. Like, that word just doesn't fit. Right? A little toddler, you wouldn't call him a Bachelor. Right? If you watch the show The Bachelor, and The Bachelor was some little 3-year-old kid, you'd be like, you'd want your money back. You'd be like, that's a ripoff. Because he's not a Bachelor. So you modify your principle. You must say, not merely being unmarried is enough. It also needs to be the case that it's sort of possible or plausible or reasonable to think that the person could be married. And so you maintain the basic idea, but you change the intention, you change the criteria, you change the formula so that it fits with the little boy not counting as a member of the extension. And you have thereby made progress. So then you pat yourself on the back, and you feel good about yourself, and there you go. And so that's reflective equilibrium applied to conceptual analysis. sense. Not whether you agree with it, not whether, you know, you liked it. Just whether you're sort of following, whether this makes sense. Give me a thumbs up if you, if it was just no sense at all, down, and then in the middle is in the middle. Okay, good. Okay. Checking the time. Now, reflective equilibrium. Let's get a little more precise. All right. So the general principles not only need to align with your judgments on cases, but it's best if they sort of support or explain your judgments on cases, right? So for example, killing is not in self-defense or defense of others wrong, right? That not only aligns with killing kidnappers, okay, but it gives a reason or an explanation or a justification for why it's okay, right? It makes sense of the judgment, right? So you don't merely just want everything to line up. You also want your principles to provide some explanation or justification for your judgments on cases. Okay. Another thing. What we've been talking about is a very sort of particular and specific sense of reflective equilibrium, right? It's this method, you know, with adjusting. And the things that you're adjusting are judgments on particular cases, whether it's moral cases or judgments about whether particular individuals belong in an extension. Right? Doing that on the one hand and also making adjustments with general principles. Right? Whether they're moral principles or in the case of conceptual analysis, intentional criteria. Right? There's also a sort of vaguer sense of reflective equilibrium. And that's just the idea of adjusting different kinds of information until you get a coherent system. Right? So in science, you have one particular object, you have two general theories, and you also have three all kinds of background assumptions. Like, for instance, your microscope works. Right? That what you see in the microscope actually is what's there. And you also have other theories and other assumptions. There's a whole lot of stuff going on, right, in science and economics. And the sort of vaguer sense of reflective equilibrium is that you're constantly modifying and balancing and weighing these different kinds of information against each other and making adjustments until you get something coherent. Right? So some people think that if you make an observation that conflicts with the theory, right, that automatically means that the theory is wrong and you just throw the theory out. Right? And that's not really how it works. Right? It's the way science is practiced. Oh, I know you guys are all only 7 more minutes. You feel this deep urge to like fold stuff and zip stuff. Okay, just sit tight. You're almost okay. But with reflective equilibrium, right, we know that the process in science is more complicated. Right? An observation that conflicts with a theory, right, might be due to something, you know, one of your background assumptions being false. It might be because there's some other theory you're relying upon that's false. It might be because your equipment is broken, right? You don't just immediately throw out the theory whenever you get a single piece of data that conflicts with it, right? You go into this process of reflective equilibrium, of taking different kinds of information, right, and balancing against each other, and making adjustments and modifications until you have coherence. Okay? And that's the sort of vaguer sense. Okay. So, give me a thumbs up, middle, or down in this last one. Okay, let's do this. Who wants to read? I've been talking and talking and talking. Who wants to read?
Nobody.
Ah, yes.
Lucia and Ursula are friends. One afternoon they hang out and they both get very drunk and decide they want to get some food and to watch a movie. So Lucia drives to the supermarket to get food and Ursula drives to Blockbuster to get a movie. On the way to the supermarket, Lucia loses control of her car and crashes into a park bench. The bench happens to be empty. The cops show up, and she ends up getting a $500 fine and her license suspended for 1 year. On the way to Blockbuster, Ursula loses control of her car and crashes into a park bench. That bench happened to have a kid sitting in it. The kid is killed. Ursula gets a 20-year prison sentence for vehicular manslaughter.
Okay. All right, everybody get the story? So Lucia and Ursula received very different punishments. However, it seems that, at least in a certain sense, that they each behaved equally badly. They each drove drunk and crashed. Relatively speaking, Lucia was lucky that the bench she hit was empty. And Ursula was just unlucky that the bench she hit had a kid sitting on it. And then the question is this large difference in their punishments? Right? One getting a $500 fine and their license suspended for a year, and the other going to jail for 20 years. Is that fair? Is that ethical? Is that right? Is that just? They both drive drunk and crash, one hits an empty bench and gets fined, the other hits a bench with kidney and kills a kid. So raise your hand if you think that the punishments they got were fair. The one who had the bench had a small punishment, the one who had the kid. Raise your hand if you think that the punishments were unfair. Raise your hand if you didn't raise your hand. Who can tell me why the punishments were fair or unfair, right or wrong? Yes, sir.
Maybe unfair because, like, they're both drunk, yet they both have, I think when you're drunk, you don't have entire control of yourself, but you have some control. But you make the choice.
Oh, I'm not nodding.
No, I'm not judging myself. But you have to make the choice to do it. So there is a law that says to judge each and every case by a similar case that has come before it. So if they're not going to judge Ursula's by Lucia's, then it's an unfair and unjust trial, and Ursula has a right to retry.
Okay.
I mean, you can't kill the kid, but they both.
Okay. I know you guys have very passionate views about Lucia and Ursula, but we're not done yet. Lucia and Ursula. So hold off on clothing and packing and all that stuff. Yes, sir.
The legal system mostly deals with consequences.
It sounds like you're about to tell me what the law is.
Well, I was gonna tie it in.
Okay, let's focus on what the law should be. So, there's a whole building on this campus that deals with criminal justice. Right? In this class, we're all philosophers. And we don't, you know, what the law is, you know, sometimes that's relevant, but really what we care about is what the law should be. So tell me what the law should be. Should they get the same punishment?
No.
Okay.
But their actions and intentions are the same thing.
Okay, good.
But in this case, because the consequence involved killing another person, it's a bit different.
Okay.
Isn't that the action part as opposed to the result of the action?
Yeah. So, yes. So the way this works out is the action they performed, you might say, is the same. They drove them. Right? Their intentions were the same. They were both equally reckless. But the consequences were radically different. One thing I really liked about what we said, and you guys do discussion boards, is the sort of, there's this reason and this reason and this reason. But there's also this reason and this consideration and this factor. But there's also this other factor, this other reason. Right? And that's what you want to do. That's actually doing this very well. If you're going through, you know, and identifying all kinds of different reasons and considerations. Okay. We're out of time. So thank you for welcoming me.